Meet the Press with Hugh Riminton.
Hello and welcome to Meet the Press. The 10th anniversary of 9/11. We will return to that subject this morning. But Parliament resumes this week with the big one.
The government will be introducing our clean energy future package of bills into the House next week.
So the carbon tax begins its journey into law as the federal opposition demands for the second time that the law take an interest in Labor backbencher Craig Thompson.
I've made comments repeatedly. I've always denied doing any wrongdoing and I continue to deny any wrongdoing.
I've consistently expressed my confidence in the member for Dobell.
No one should think that he's been cleared. There are still a lot of questions for Craig Thompson to answer.
In the economy, growth improves, but unemployment still rises. The unions digging in for the next potential workplace war.
The scorched earth economic approach that low wages leads to more jobs has been totally discredited by the US recession.
And then there's asylum seeker policy. With the High Court rejecting the Malaysia solution, the Greens will reject anything but processing here.
We Greens won't have it. I won't have it.
Do not persist with Malaysia. But there's nothing wrong with Nauru.
But the government is still working the Malaysia option.
We are confident that the right legislative tools can be put in place.
The Attorney General Robert McClelland is our guest this morning, and later an eyewitness with a unique view on those terrible events of a decade ago today. We speak with Australia's former Consul General in New York, Ken Allen. But first, Melinda Nusafora has what's making news this Sunday, September 11.
Thanks, Hugh. And here are the major stories this morning. Services have begun in the United States to remember the victims of the 9/11 attacks 10 years ago. At a memorial dedication ceremony in Pennsylvania, former President George W. Bush said the passengers and crew of Flight 93 who fought back against their hijackers were responsible for one of the most courageous acts in American history. In New York, where security was tight around the World Trade Center site, people gathered to remember 9/11 by holding hands in a human chain. And in Washington, President Obama and his wife Michelle visited Arlington National Cemetery to pay tribute to servicemen and women killed in the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan. The federal cabinet will discuss the controversial issue of offshore processing tomorrow after the Immigration Department confirmed there are 14 unaccompanied children on board the latest asylum seeker boat to arrive in Christmas Island. The vessel is the first to arrive since the High Court rejected the government's Malaysia solution. And volunteers have joined Libyan rebel fighters in an all-out assault on Bani Walid, one of Colonel Gaddafi's last strongholds. The main fighting was taking place near the town's main gates as NATO drones and planes patrolled the skies and launched airstrikes. And Hugh, those are the main headlines this morning. Back to you.
Melinda, thank you. Now, welcome to the program, Robert McClelland. Good morning, Attorney
General. Good morning.
You've got a cabinet meeting on tomorrow. You are the first law officer of the land. Do you have a solution in your back pocket to offer them?
Well, these things have got to be debated clearly, and obviously cabinet will consider a possible legislative amendment to the Migration Act, and clearly we have advice and we'll be giving advice to cabinet on those options. There's no question about that. And then after cabinet decides on the course of action, it will go to caucus shortly thereafter for a decision to be made. But there's certainly options available.
So you say options in the plural?
There's various drafting techniques as to how this can be framed, but in terms of the various outcomes, I think they've been out there publicly as to whether it is drafted to encompass three particular sites, whether it's one particular site, or indeed a broader discretion to the minister. They're essentially the drafting options.
But you expect then an answer through cabinet tomorrow, that this will be a decision that you'll get out tomorrow?
I expect so. Obviously, there'll be an agenda item, but I expect there'll be a cabinet decision and subsequently a caucus decision. There'll be debate, as there always is, on issues of significance, and that'll be the case here.
So if you have the caucus after the cabinet, is caucus given effectively a fait accompli? This is what we've come up with. You can debate but that's what it is.
I think the ALP caucus over the years has shown that it'll never accept a fait accompli. Obviously, caucus is highly influenced by whatever the cabinet decision is, but that doesn't stop them debating or indeed determining the issue. So that's part of the history of the Labor Party. You never get a tame caucus in the Labor Party, and nor should you.
I'm sure you've been looking at this pretty closely. Is there a single set of words that you can use in legislation to amend the Migration Act that would cover potentially both Malaysia and Nauru or any other offshore option?
Oh, there's various options, and certainly there's words that are appropriate in each instance, and ultimately after the Cabinet decision is made, it'll go to the parliamentary drafters for even more detailed work, but there's clearly various sets of words that you can use in respect to each instance.
And reactivating Malaysia is plainly the intent?
Well, again, it's not my call. I mean, that's Minister Bowen's call, but clearly that is going to be very much part of the focus of debate in Cabinet and caucus.
Why is that? Why Malaysia?
Well, the advice, I mean, there's been reports of briefings given by the Immigration Department, and I wasn't a party to those, but essentially it's about trying to destroy the people smugglers model so that essentially you take away their market. What's the point of paying a people smuggler if you actually go back to the end of the queue, so to speak?
And Nauru doesn't work, in your view?
The problem with Nauru is it's not all that different from what happens on Christmas Island. Christmas Island is, albeit it's Australian territory, but it is an offshore territory. It's Nauru, yes, it's a different country, but essentially it is the same sort of processing system. And if you look at the figures, most of the people processed on Nauru ended up coming to Australia or New Zealand.
So if you can get this legislative amendment through Cabinet, through caucus and then on, you still have the political issue. You've got the Greens saying they'll only back onshore processing. You've had clear statements from Tony Abbott saying that Malaysia is no good, he'll only support Nauru. Now, between the two of them, they own the Senate. So are we in danger of having a sustained political stalemate in getting any legislative changes through? And in the interim, flotillas of boats are arriving with children, or possibly not arriving, possibly sinking.
Well, it's a feature of minority government that you've always got to negotiate for your legislation, but equally we've had quite a good track record of getting that through. Clearly there'll be work to be done, there'll be negotiations to be had.
This is unique, really, isn't it? Because you have been getting legislation through, but this is one where the Greens and the Coalition, for different reasons, are trenchantly opposing your preferred option.
Well, again, I just want to stress that the option has to be determined through those processes. But it's a matter of working through those issues, a matter of working through the merits. At the end of the day, it's a question as to whether everyone involved wants to address people smuggling or they want to score political points. That's the straight out discussion.
Mm. Did the High Court get it wrong?
Look, again, my job isn't to second guess the High Court's reasoning. We think, certainly we prefer one of the judges' reasoning that traced the authority that we relied on or our legal advisers relied on to advise the government. Having said that, the High Court essentially said that the legislation passed by Philip Ruddock had to be construed consistently with our international obligations. So that's an analysis.
So was the Prime Minister wrong to criticise the court decision?
Well, again, I think criticising the reasoning of a judge is always fair game. And she made a point and she's absolutely right. She did not criticise the judges personally, didn't challenge their motives, their competence.
So that's the threshold that would require you as the first law officer to go in and defend the judges who can't speak for themselves, is that they have to be criticised personally before you would stand up and defend them?
Criticising judicial reasoning is always fair game in our system. What is inappropriate is any criticism, and it wasn't made of the judges personally or their motives. That's my role to ensure that barrier is maintained.
OK, we're going to take a break. When we return with the panel, the lessons of 9/11. Our takeoff of the week. You know until someone's taking the mickey. The ABC's At Home with Julia.
I have recorded it, so I will watch it, and I hope that I will be laughing as I do.
No doubt they'll get Rowan Atkinson to play me.
It's not like anything's going to happen at an international conference, is it?